Hi, it's Carly McAvoy. I want to talk about measures of relative standing, and those are numbers that show the location of data values relative to other values within a data set. They can compare values within a data set or between different data sets if certain criteria is met. Common measures that we're looking at of relative standing are z-scores, percentiles, and quartiles. This video is particularly about z-scores. Number of standard deviations at a given value x is above or below the mean is what a z-score is. And the formulas are pretty simple. If you have a sample, you're going to use the standard deviation s, and if you have a population, you're going to use the standard deviation given by lowercase sigma. If you have a sample, you're going to take your value, whatever your value is, and subtract the mean of the sample. And over here, you're using mu, which is the mean of the population. If a value is less than the mean, it's going to have a negative z-score. And if it's greater than the mean, it has a positive z-score. So z-scores are very related to standard deviation. But standard deviation, we look at things as positive, whether it's less than or greater than. A standard deviation of 1 means we don't know if it's left or right unless we say. So a z-score gives us a chance to look at things that might be negative or positive. So here's an example. Researchers looked at the test scores of 50 students from various high schools. They randomly selected two test scores. The first was 42.8 and the second was 89.6. The complete set of students had a mean of 62.5 and a standard deviation of 10.1. And so we're kind of getting to this finding z-score. So we're first asking, what's the difference between the higher test score selected and the mean of the 50 tests, and the lower test score selected in the mean of all 50 tests? So those are two different things we're looking for here. We want to do it for each of these. And when we talk about the difference, we're really looking at this up here, right? We're looking at that top part. So that's pretty simple. For the higher test score, we're going to take the score that we were given, 89.6, and subtract the mean, 62.5, and we find that it has a difference of 27.1. For the lower test score, we're going to take the 42.8 and subtract the 62.5, and that gives us a difference of negative 19.7. The first question is how many standard. The next question is how many standard deviations is that from that's the difference we're looking for here. What's the standard deviations? And to find the standard deviation, we take the absolute value of that number given and divide by the standard deviation. So we're going to take 27.1 and divide by the 10.1, and that gives us 2.68 standard deviations for the higher test score. For the lower test score, it was negative 19.7, but for standard deviation, we're not talking about negative and positive. We're just going to take the absolute value of that 19.7, divide by 10.1, and we get 1.95 as our standard deviation. Now we're asked to convert these two test scores into z-scores. And now z-scores, we can start to talk about negative versus positive. And so when I look at that, the higher test z-score was 2.68, but the lower test score was negative 1.95. Remember I said earlier, if it's less than the mean, it's going to have a negative z-score. If it's greater than the mean, it's going to have a positive z-score. And we can also see that when we subtract the value minus the mean, if it's a lesser value, we're going to get a negative, and that's going to indicate to us that we have a negative z-score. It's on the left side of the mean. If we consider the test scores, it should be, that convert to z-scores between negative 2 and 2, to be neither significantly low nor significantly high, are either of these test scores significant? So what we're saying is everything between negative 2 and positive 2 z-scores are not significant. They fall within that 95%. And sometimes you can see 95.4, but 95 is a pretty standard thing, so I'm going to go with 95 here. If 95% of the scores fall between negative 2 and 2. So if it's in that range, then that score is not significant in any way. So the higher test score has a z-score of more than 2. That was 2.68. So if this is 2, it's somewhere out here. And so that one is significant. But the lower test score had a test score that was a z-score that was negative 1.95. And anything back to negative 2 is okay, and negative 1.95 would be around here, and so it's not significant. It falls within that range of scores that we would consider to be not unusual. It's not unusual to be in the first two standard deviations on either side. And then for the next one, During Sydney's heat, the mean time to finish the race was 23.45 minutes, and the standard deviation was 1.33 minutes. She finished the race in 21.15 minutes. During Seth's heat, the mean time to finish the race was 25.30 minutes and had a standard deviation of 1.25 minutes. Seth finished the race with a time of 27.6 minutes. So we're looking at these two people. They were running in with different groups of people, so there was a different mean and there was a different standard deviation for their races. So what we were asking is, relative to the heats that they ran in, who had the more extreme time? In other words, the time that was more extreme when you look at standard deviations or z-scores. And then they were saying, did either of them have a negative z-score? And would you rather have a positive or negative z-score in this situation? And I want to answer the second question first, because we should be able to answer that without figuring that out mathematically. The mean time in Sydney's race was 23.45, and she finished in 21.15. So hopefully you can see that she was below the mean, and so she would have a negative z-score. Seth was running in a race that had an average of 25.3, and Seth finished in 27.6. So Seth was higher than the mean, so his z-score should be positive, Sydney's should be negative, and that's what we're going to discover. She was below the mean time, so she had a negative z-score. So how do we figure out what their z-scores are? Well, for Sydney, we're going to take her time of 21.15 and subtract the average, which is 23.45. And then divide by the standard deviation. And that's going to give us a negative 1.73. So that's her z-score. But as a standard deviation, we would just say 1.73. Because standard deviations, we don't include the negative. Seth's was his time, 27.6, minus the average. Minus the average, which is 25.3 divided by standard deviation. His is 1.84. Seth's time put him 1.84 standard deviations from the mean. And so Seth has a more extreme time relative to his heat. And then would you rather have a negative or positive z-score in this situation? Well, it's nice when you're faster. And if you're faster, then you have a lower time than the mean. So for a race, a negative z-score actually means you're faster, and that's what most people would want. So z-score being negative doesn't automatically mean it's a bad thing. All right, have a fantastic day.